Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. On behalf of His Excellency Dr. Jamal Sanad al-Suwaidi, Director General of the Emirates Center for Strategic Studies and Research, we would like to welcome you all to the center, where we are gathered here this evening for the much-anticipated lecture, Obama's Wars, due to be presented by the renowned journalist Bob Woodward. Since 1971, Bob Woodward has worked for the Washington Post, where he is currently an associate editor. He and Carl Bernstein were the main reporters on the Washington scandal, on the Watergate scandal, for which the newspaper won the Pulitzer Prize in 1973. He was the lead reporter for the Washington Post's articles on the aftermath of the September 11th terrorist attacks that won the National Affairs Pulitzer Prize in 2002. Bob Woodward was born in Illinois. He later graduated from Yale University in 1965 and served for 5 years as a communications officer in the United States Navy prior to embarking upon a career in journalism at the Montgomery County Sentinel, Maryland, where he was a reporter for 1 year before joining the Washington Post. Woodward has authored and co-authored 17 books, all of which have been national nonfiction bestsellers. His most recent book, The Price of Politics, September 2012, is based on 18 months of reporting and is an intimate documented examination of how President Obama and the highest profile Republican and Democratic leaders in the United States Congress attempted to restore the American economy and improving the federal government's fiscal condition. Among Woodward's other books notably include All the President's Men, All the President's Men, The Final Days, Veil the Secret Wars of the CIA 1981-1987, The Agenda, Inside the Clinton White House, Bush and at War, and Obama's Wars. Now I'm pleased to invite Mr. Bob Woodward to present his lecture.
Thank you. It's great to be here. I want to introduce my wife, Elsa. Would you stand up and say hello? She came all the way from the United States with me, and we've enjoyed, we were in Dubai for 4 days, and we've enjoyed seeing Abu Dhabi here. What I'm going to do is try to compress this a little bit. It clearly is a serious moment in international relations, much going on. And at the same time, I want to give a little bit of a history of some of the experiences that President Obama has had. Some I've been reported in my book, some elsewhere, and a couple of these things have not been reported, but I think are integral to understanding him. And if there's a theme, I guess I would say in America we are experiencing the age of the presidency, that presidents in our country have always been important, but I think the concentration of power in the presidency since Nixon up through Obama has only grown. So how did we get to where we are, November 2015, with the rise of the Islamic State, the tragedy in Paris, the announcement now by the Russians that the plane was taken down by a bomb and the Islamic State or ISIS, whatever you want to call it, has taken credit, and other bombings in places like Beirut. So go back to 2008, when, after Obama had been elected president, and one of the first briefings he had was from the CIA director, Michael Hayden. Now, Hayden had been the National Security Agency director also before, and he was a four-star Air Force general. And they started introducing Obama to operations that had just begun under President Bush, these drone strikes, the pilotless aircraft that can go and hover and carry missiles and attack and kill people. And Obama, this is an important moment. He's not yet president, but he's been elected. I forget his precise age at that point, but I think it was 22 or 23. Not literally, but he was very young, very inexperienced. And he thought, oh, these drones, that's wonderful. It's kind of a riskless free. There's no risk, really, in sending these drones out. And General Hayden, CIA director, said to the president, you know, you can't win wars from the air. That there have been bombing studies about the Vietnam War, World War II, and you have to find a way to impact or control conditions on the ground. Obama, because at this moment in 2008, 7 years ago, the big threat was Al-Qaeda. They had sanctuaries in Pakistan. There was a secret agreement so the United States could operate these drones and strike Al-Qaeda leaders in Pakistan. Now then, the next year, 2009, if you can recall back, one of the things Obama and Secretary of State Hillary Clinton were doing, it was an outreach to Syria. They wanted to patch up relations with President Assad. And one of the things that was occurring, and this has not been reported, but I think it's important to understand, is that the intelligence agencies, the CIA and so forth, were putting in the top secret report that went each morning to Obama, intelligence showing how awful President Assad was, and some of his more brutal activities. And this kept coming in the daily, it's called the Presidential Daily Brief. Finally, the intelligence people were called in by Obama's White House aides and said, you know, don't put that in, we're trying to patch things up with Assad. The intelligence people were not happy, and of course, in a very real way, this is a rookie mistake for to come out and say, oh, don't give me the bad news, don't tell me something about somebody I'm trying to develop relations with. By May 2010, one of the things the Obama administration had to do is put out what's called a national security strategy. It would be public and would explain, this is what we're up to, these are our values, this is what we care about. And the draft report said, and this was based on interviews that the security staff had done with Obama, we kind of want to focus on economic sanctions, diplomacy, law enforcement, and the draft language was such that it said, look, yeah, war, that's an option, but not one that we actually ever want to do. And the language was not very strong. And one of Obama's top advisors in this meeting said, look, this is the weakest statement on the use of force that we have ever seen or we have ever contemplated putting out. And President Obama said to his advisors, But that's what I believe, that war is, in a sense, on the table, but not really. We must avoid war. Then Obama pulled out of Iraq completely. The generals in the Pentagon were almost literally on their knees begging him, do not pull out all of the U.S. forces. Buy an insurance policy. Keep 10,000, 15,000 troops there. United States at that time and still has about 39,000 troops in South Korea. And that war was 65 years ago. Obama wanted out completely. So he took all the U.S. troops out at that point. In Afghanistan, because when he campaigned in 2008, he was arguing very, very aggressively that Afghanistan is the good war, Iraq is the bad war, so he was willing to add 30,000 more troops to the Afghanistan conflict, but he said in announcing this during the end of 2009, he said, in 2 years, we're going to start pulling them out. This was much criticized because the feeling was that in Afghanistan, the Taliban could just say, okay, now we just have to hold on for 2 more years. During this period, I had breakfast with one of the world leaders, heads of state, one of the America's very best, most important allies. And I asked, obviously, about what this prime minister thought of Obama, and he said, I like him, he's really smart, but no one is afraid of him. And my heart sank because that's exactly what the reporting was showing, that he was sending unintentionally with you know, does not like war, and he's sincere about that, but unintentionally sending a message of weakness. Then the question arose, what do we do with Syria? And the president, as you may recall, said, well, Assad must go. He also said, if Syria uses chemical weapons, that is a red line. He said that the Islamic State at that point, which was forming in Iraq and Syria, was the junior varsity. And it's finally the United States decided to support some of the opposition to Assad in literally spending millions of dollars. And this has been acknowledged that they trained 5 people in this opposition. So, where we step into this next is President finally decided to add some troops in Iraq. He was going to pull out of Afghanistan completely, but now he says, okay, we'll keep an insurance policy of maybe 10,000 troops there. The result, the summary of this is that President Obama and his administration has made the United States a humble superpower. And I remember a couple of weeks ago talking to a group of lawyers and was making this point about it seems as if the United States has become this humble superpower with this great military. And I just said to them, what about a humble litigator, a humble lawyer? How effective would that person be? And you could just hear them say, you know, that is not the way you can be an effective lawyer. And in the world now, humility, a wonderful virtue, unfortunately doesn't work. And if you look around the world, do the reporting with the American and other intelligence agencies, You find in 20 countries, the fuse of instability is lit. Don't know whether it's a short fuse or a long fuse, that there is not this kind of hardness and toughness. This became really clear to me when I was doing the book, Obama's Wars, about in 2010, went to the Oval Office to interview him on a Saturday morning, and I had sent him about 12 pages of questions with details, but also wanted to see if it was possible to dig a little deeper into his basic attitude, particularly his basic attitude toward war. We knew he didn't like the Iraq war, and he had said publicly he's not against all wars, he's only against dumb wars. So at the end of the interview, he's walking out of the Oval Office, and I was in my best suit, and he was dressed to go play golf, and so I could tell he was in a hurry, but I just said one more question, and handed him a quote from a World War II book written by a former colleague of mine, Rick Atkinson, at the Washington Post. And the book is called Day of Battle, and at one point, Rick Atkinson steps back and talks about war in general, and I typed out this quote and handed it to the president. And the quote essentially says that, war teaches the people on the ground the importance of honor and courage, but then it goes on, and Obama read this, there is the saddest lesson of all to be learned in war again and again. That war is corrupting, that it corrodes the soul and tarnishes the spirit, and even the excellent and the superior can be defiled, and that no heart would remain unstained in war. Pretty dreary view of war, and Obama immediately said, I sympathize with this view. Go read my Nobel Prize acceptance speech. I had seen his speech, I had read it, and I raced home, got it out, and if unfortunately this happens to me too frequently where I have seen something and read something but don't really understand its full meaning. And so I read it again, and in his speech, the president laid out, he said, look, the instruments of war do have a role to play in preserving peace. But the soldier's courage and sacrifice is there. It expresses important devotion to country. But then he went on to say, war is never glorious. You may recall that Churchill said, war is delicious. Obama, it is never glorious. I think he's right. And we must never trumpet it as such. But war, though sometimes necessary, is always a manifestation or an expression of human folly. And I think after I got done reading that and finishing the book, I realized that his aversion to war and conflict is so great and deep that he will almost avoid it at any cost. The result has been that we have now essentially a no ground war option in the national security strategy. The strategy is, the president just said, before the Paris terrorist attack, said that the strategy is containment of particularly the Islamic State, and we are containing them. And if you just looked at what President Obama yesterday was talking about, say he's not going to change his strategy, it's not going to be more aggressive. Even some of the columnists who are very favorable toward Obama said the president was defensive, patronizing and dismissive as people were insisting, trying to get him to do something much more aggressive. One of the nice things about being a reporter is you can, particularly somebody who's done it as long as I have, you have the luxury of time. And it was, I think, 8 years ago as I was working on it was the fourth book on George Bush's wars, I went to see Robert McNamara. Robert McNamara was the Secretary of Defense for President Kennedy and Johnson, one of the architects of the Vietnam War. When I went to see him in 2007, he was 91 years old, and we should all be as alert and in touch with reality as much as he was at age 91. And it's the last interview he gave. And I'd known him for years, and the question was, you know, what's going on with, particularly at this point, the war in Iraq, and the very, very important question of how do presidents get it wrong sometimes? And what McNamara said is, you know, the big mistake, he said, I remember he's sitting on this couch in this apartment he and his wife had in the Watergate, of all places, and he said, what happens is presidents want to avoid conflict, that they never get all of their advisors together and really hash it out and have a Donnybrook. And so everything gets filtered. And he said, that was the big mistake with Lyndon Johnson. We never all got together and listened. And if you look at the way President Obama runs the White House now, there are a lot of people who have not had a great deal of experience. He is the dominant voice and the dominant force in the White House, as the president inevitably is going to be. But there are not people there who will come and challenge him regularly. There also is not this these moments where they all get together, the top people, and say, okay, what do you really think? What's going on? How do we fix all of this? We now look at the national security moment we are in. After Paris, the French president ordered that 20 bombs be dropped on the Islamic State in Syria. And this was described as ferocious and merciless. And I've done books going back some time, and I think we've lost sight of what real military force is. If you go back to the 1991 Gulf War here, Desert Storm, President Bush Sr. ordered 100,000 sorties of bombers. 88,000 tons of bombs were dropped in 1 month. Hundreds of thousands of bombs. If you go back to 1998, when Bill Clinton was president, Clinton, not known as somebody who is militarily aggressive, in one operation called Desert Fox, an attack, a bombing attack for 4 days, little remembered, little noticed, in Iraq, there were 800 sorties, thousands of bombs were dropped. And now we, for some reason, are describing 20 bombs as ferocious and merciless. In the last book I did, which just came out last month, The Last of the President's Men, about, goes back to Nixon, the man who disclosed Nixon's secret taping system, Alexander Butterfield. He'd never told his story. And when I went to visit him, turned out he'd carted off 20 boxes of documents from the Nixon White House. He was only able to do this because he was the one who was responsible and had the job of keeping others from taking documents from the Nixon White House. And in there is a memo, a truly shocking memo in Nixon's handwriting in early 1972, after he'd been president for 3 years and ordered the bombing of North Vietnam, Laos, and Cambodia to the tune of 2.9 million tons of bombs. Millions of bombs Nixon ordered, and in a moment of candor wrote to Henry Kissinger, his national security advisor, said, all this years of bombing, we've accomplished zilch, nothing. It's a failure. So that year he's running for re-election. He knows bombing is symbolically very important and popular in the United States at that time. So he intensified the bombing and bombed more, essentially, to help him win re-election, as he did. We now look back at all of these bombing campaigns, and we realize that the intensity of the bombing, whether it's 20 or millions of bombs, when, as General Hayden said, you really aren't changing things on the ground. It, among the people being bombed, it builds morale, it helps their propaganda as it did the Vietnamese, and it creates a sense among people who are being bombed. Yes, many hundreds or thousands may be killed, but the impact militarily, as Nixon said, essentially is zilch. And it creates that sense of we're holding the fort down. And as General Hayden told Obama 7 years ago, you have to change the conditions on the ground. And if you look at where we are at this moment, and it's a difficult moment, there is no strategy to do that. Now, who's going to take over from Obama? This is one of the great questions. In terms of the Democratic nomination, Hillary Clinton, it looks like she is going to win, but I think in the internet age of impatience and speed, that can turn upside down in a matter of days or weeks. Do we know who she is one of the great questions. And I want to tell a story about an encounter with her 10 years ago that shows this side we don't see. It's a very tough side. This is a tough woman. And it was 2005. I was giving a talk like this in Washington. And she was the other speaker. And after we'd given our talks, she came up and said, oh, I quote from one of your Bush books all the time, but you were here tonight, so I didn't do it, but I normally do quote from it. In fact, she said, I quote so often, I think I should pay you royalties. I stupidly said no, rather than how much. And I said, well, what is it you quote? And she said, oh, it's the end of the second book, Plan of Attack, about how Bush decided to invade Iraq in 2003. And I was able to get the notes of the National Security Council meetings, interview people, go back, interview President Bush for hours. And after the end of the second day of interviews with Bush, he was standing in the Oval Office, had his hands in his pockets, and I just asked, how, and this was not on a list of questions but just came to my mind, said, how do you think history will judge your Iraq war? And I think the mention of history caused him to reflect back on all those history exams at Yale that he did not do very well on. And so he, when asked the question about history, he takes his hands out of his pockets and throws them in the air and says, history, we won't know, we'll all be dead. Comforting thought. Went home and Elsa asked me, how did the interview go? And I said, I think he answered most of the questions, but the really good news is I have the ending to the book. Endings are really hard to find. And if you think about it, he's ducking the question, history, we won't know, we'll all be dead. But there's a certain truth in that, that the interpretation of events, particularly wars, often changes over time. And so I asked Senator Clinton then, this is 2005, she's senator gearing up to run for president in 2008 for the first time. And so I, well, why do you quote that? And she's, and then this is the Hillary you don't see in public. She really got intense and said, look, I'm telling you, and she started pounding her hand into her fist into her hand, and she was kind of, the fist was flying around, so I stepped back. I said, I am telling you, you cannot think and talk like that and be president of the United States. And I said, well, what do you mean? And she said, well, George Bush is a fatalist. You cannot be, a fatalist means somebody who they do what they think is right, but then they leave it for others to interpret or analyze or judge. And I think I said something like, Lincoln was a bit of a fatalist. And then she really, the fist started flying, said, look, I am telling you, you cannot think and talk like that and be president of the United States. I remember thinking, if she ever becomes president, she's in the Oval Office, somebody asks her, how do you think history will judge your big decision, whatever it might be? Her answer will be, I will write it. I'm sure she would, but she is in there, and I'm pushing back on, well, you know, that what's wrong with, and said, look, I'm telling you, you cannot think and talk like that and be president of the United States. George Washington would never, ever think like that and talk like that, Washington being the first U.S. president. Thomas Jefferson never, ever would think and talk like that, another early American president. Bill would never, ever think and talk like that. And I remember thinking, the new Mount Rushmore, Washington, Jefferson, and they tear down Teddy Roosevelt and put Bill in there, and maybe Hillary. And I was going to say something, but then I caught myself thinking, we won't know. We'll all be dead. Let me stop there and spend some time on your questions, which I left some extra time for that. And Gordon Liddy, if any of you remember who that was, has supplied microphones tonight.
Thank you.
He was one of the Watergate people.
Thank you, Mr. Woodward, for this invaluable lecture, which enabled us to gain a closer insight into the U.S. President Barack Obama's leadership style and the inner workings of his administration, and also Hillary Clinton, the next president, might be.
Again, I'm sorry, it's bouncing around here.
Oh. We'll sit here and then.
Oh, you want me to sit here? Okay.
Yeah. Okay. We shall now open the floor for discussion, which will run for approximately half an hour. Should you wish to ask a question or make a comment, please stand up, introduce yourself, and try to make your question or comments as brief as possible to ensure that as many people as possible are given the chance of contributing to the discussion.
Okay, Dr. Saleh, I'm...
I am Dr. Saleh, I'm a researcher. So,
in Arabic,
you spoke about an important topic when you referred to Robert McNamara, and I know as his background, he was an engineer and he was chief of staff of the United States Army. His definition of security was so important. When I reviewed all the definitions of the security, he said that security is a development, and development is the security, and no security, there is no security without development, and no development without security. And at the age of 91, we link that definition with the strategy of the United States when you refer to the containment. How can we compare containment and security and development? And development is required by the people. Thank you, sir.
The dilemma of containment it works. Now I'm getting a translation. Okay. containment works. It worked in the Cold War because there was deterrence, right? There was United States had tens of thousands of nuclear weapons. The Soviet Union had the same, so all the incentives were not to use it, right? So how does containment work when we don't really know how much we can do to the Islamic State, and the incentive for them is, oh, well, if they're trying to destroy particular government or culture, what price are they going to pay? And so it's something that sounds good, but I don't think it can be that effective with a terrorist organization.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Jamil Mohammed from ECAE. The disastrous intervention by Bush, Bush's disastrous intervention into Iraq, which were built on lies and the resultant mess that we find the Middle East presently in. Do you believe that Obama's policies is based upon the effects, after effects of Bush's policy? That's part one.
Okay.
I'll repeat again. Bush's intervention, George Bush intervened into Iraq based on lies. This is resulting in a total mess in the Middle East. So therefore, another president, Obama, came into office. He's using different tools to clear the mess of Bush. That's, if you'd like to comment on that. The second point, do you believe that Obama is using Iran as a tool? America has a good relationship with Iran. The relationship was beneath the table. Now they've cleaned Iran up to serve America's policies in Syria, in Yemen, in Bahrain, and in Lebanon. Thank you.
Okay, let's take the first, that the weapons of mass destruction was built on lies. It turned out to be wrong. I spent a couple of years looking at exactly the road George Bush walked when he decided to invade Iraq. I think he believed there were weapons of mass destruction. The CIA director, George Tenet, came in and told him it was a slam dunk case that there were weapons of mass destruction. But the real driver, and again, this is one of these things you discover when you spend the time talking to these people and trying to get the documents and the intelligence assessments and the war plan in Iraq, is initially presented to President Bush just a couple of months after 9/11 looked like it was going to take 500,000 troops and take a year. And the military kept telling him as it evolved that it was going to take less troops and less time. And it, so it looked, if you've ever remodeled or renovated a home, the first time the contractor will tell you, you know, it's going to cost $1 million and take a year, and then you go through iterations of it, and the last time they tell you it's going to take a weekend and cost $1.25, it's much easier to do that. And that's essentially what happened with the war plan. It looked like it was going to be easy. And of course, it turned out not to be. And if I may take a personal confessional moment here, I wrote a story for my newspaper, The Washington Post, before the war began, and said that there is no smoking gun intelligence that Iraq has weapons of mass destruction. I should have understood what I wrote, because if you don't have smoking gun intelligence, you don't have hard evidence. If you don't have hard evidence, you don't have much. And I fault myself mightily for not understanding, when you don't have smoking gun intelligence, what that means. The government should have done the same thing, but I look at myself and say I failed mightily on this front. It was an easy mistake to make, a mistake that should not have been made. So there is this storyline that it was built on lies. It actually was a mistake, and a serious one that should not have been made. But George Bush and Dick Cheney were not sitting there and saying, you know, we know there aren't weapons of mass destruction, but let's invade anyway. That's not what happened. They believed the weapons of mass destruction were there, and they also believed that the Iraqi people were going to greet them with flowers and song, as Cheney said. And of course, that turned out not to be the case. It's a monumental blunder. You have, in trying to understand and get to the inner Obama, what Obama really feels, he looks at the Iraq war and that monumental mistake and says, I'm not going to make it myself. I'm going to keep us out of massive ground operations. And as I tried to point out, just does not like war. Now, I happen to share that view. I think war turns out to be a disaster almost always. And so you have to kind of understand Obama's attitude, having the experience of watching the Iraq war, opposing it, and seeing it leading in part to much of, or certainly some of the mess that exists in the Middle East. There was another part to the question. Okay. I think that he's using Iran as a tool to clean up the mess. No, I think again what Obama wants to avoid, some sort of, needless to say, war, or particularly some sort of nuclear exchange in the Middle East, and wants to prevent Iran from getting a nuclear weapon. I think almost everyone's in agreement that let's prevent Iran from getting a nuclear weapon. The deal that was made has received much criticism, is legitimate criticism. How many people here this evening have been at one point or another in your life engaged in a negotiation? Please raise your hands. The longer we wait, the more hands go up. How many people are married? It's the same question, right? And what do you learn in a negotiation? You have to spend time. You, all night, weekends, you have to go back, and you have to do something that people hate to do, and that is listen to the other side. And when you reach some sort of agreement, it gets down to a kind of a formula, which is you get one thing, I get one thing. You get one thing, I get one thing. And that's what the Iran deal is. I've looked at it in some detail, but I'm by no means an expert on it. But I think it makes sense as a negotiation, and the chief criticism of it is, well, how about 10 years from now, what are we going to do? Well, God knows what we're going to do in 2 years. And so I think, quite frankly, and this is neutral, nonpartisan analysis, and as you know, I've criticized Obama on lots of these things. I think this is something that he and Secretary of State John Kerry did a good job on, and that it is a step on the right road. It obviously doesn't solve everything, but it's nice to see a step on the right road.
Hi. My name is Warren Fox from Abu Dhabi and California. First, I want to thank you. I was a professor for years teaching American government, and because of you, all the material on Watergate was endless for classrooms, and it really engaged students with real-world examples about American government. Great, great stuff. And I have a question from that time. I've always been interested in Alexander Butterfield, who had those tapes in the White House that led to the 7.5-minute gap from Rosemary Woods and all of that. He just kind of sort of came on the scene. Did people know that he was there? Did he volunteer himself? Did you find him in your investigation? How did he come forward? I mean, it was a revelation that there were tapes in the White House about the cover-up in Watergate that just seemed to rock the whole the whole case. And I never really kind of understood how he got started and why he agreed.
Okay, well, the latest book, The Last of the President's Men, answers all your questions and explains where he came from and the road he walked and why he disclosed the taping system. And there's a 30-page section of the book that is kind of a psychological profile of somebody making a big decision because he knew or believed strongly that the tapes would destroy Nixon. And so he knew he had his finger on that trigger. He wanted to do it in a way that would protect himself legally, and he, at the same time, was not willing to come forward. But in going back and doing this, what I hope is the last Nixon book, it reminds you history's never over. We think we know things, and we don't. We get little slivers of them, and what is in the Butterfield documents in his story that's in this book is a whole new dimension to Nixon. And I won't go through the examples, but it was really a surprise to me. And I've kind of thought at age 72, I'm too old to ever be surprised, particularly by Nixon. And I was.
No, after one. After one, Good evening, Mr. Woodward. Thank you for your presentation. My name is Dania Khatib. I'm an independent researcher. I want to point out to your previous book, The War Within, a great work. You mentioned what Malki did and the mistakes of the US that led to the radicalization of the Sunnis. And obviously, what we live now is partly the mistake of the US, their mistake in Iraq that led the radicalization of the Sunnis when they undertook the de-Baathification. And then they had a mistake also in Syria when Obama encouraged the revolution, then they didn't deliver on their promise. This led many people who defected from the army to join the radical and the Islamist. Don't you think that now America, because this is partly what we see now, is partly, to a large extent, the result of America's mistakes in the region. America should be more responsible and should not disengage from the region the way Obama is doing, just being passive and putting the blame on his allies. Bush was a horrible president, we all know that, but at least he was responsible. When there was a surge in violence in Iraq, he did the surge, and they did the awakening and the national reconciliation. Don't you think that the Obama administration should be a bit more responsible? Thank you.
You're going to have to... It bounces. I'm not hearing the question, even though it's in English.
Yeah, she asked about the responsibility of Obama towards the area here. Bush was more...
Yeah, I mean, here's what I extract from this, and I've thought a lot about it. And that is, Obama doesn't like war. He doesn't want to commit ground forces. He doesn't want to have another Iraq war. He thinks it is turned out to be a disaster. Go back to Reagan when he was president. What the trajectory of Reagan as president was the following. He started out tough. He said, the Soviet Union's an evil empire. He said, tear down that wall in Berlin. He was very aggressive, and people kind of thought, he's the mad bomber, right? Mm-hmm. But then, when Gorbachev came to power, Reagan said, oh, this is somebody I can negotiate with. And Reagan had the insight, which I think was an important one, that the Cold War and the possibility of a nuclear weapons exchange on any level did not have to be a permanent state. It is something that could be negotiated. And so he started negotiating with Gorbachev, and they made advances, and he scared the hell out of Gorbachev with this thing called the Strategic Defense Initiative, which was a defensive shield in theory that would make it so the Soviet nuclear missiles couldn't get through. And Reagan knew it wasn't even out of the laboratory, didn't exist, but Gorbachev was so worried about it, it scared the hell out of him. And so in many ways, that's where, that led to the demise of the Soviet Union, or it started on that. So you've got the trajectory of a president starting out, I'm the mad bomber, I'm crazy, I'm tough, and then saying, okay, let's negotiate our problem. Let's really sit down, and that happened. With Obama, it's the opposite. He started out saying, I don't want war. I'm going to avoid war. There was, you have to be tough, particularly in the world we live in. And Obama, look, I think it is as sincere as anything has ever been in American politics. His sense of, I want to avoid these wars, but you have to, and the prime minister who said, no one's afraid of him. you know, you want, particularly when you are this superpower, you don't want to be the humble superpower. You want to be the superpower that everyone's afraid of. Mm-hmm. And in that way, I think you can protect your country and the interests much better than philosophically saying, you know, I don't like war. War is always, yes, a manifestation of human folly. But does, you know, sometimes it's the human folly on the part of others.
مساء الخير سيد بوب.
Good evening, Mr. Woodward. I think he's speaking in English, Mr. Woodward. One minute. لحظة. When Obama came to power, he found from George Bush three wars, Iraq, Afghanistan, and the growth of the Russian army, in addition to the economic, educational, and health problems, and the weakness of the Security Council. And as we know, there is no consensus on the Middle East issues. And after now, after one year, Obama will leave power. He has withdrawn from Afghanistan. There is acceptance in weakening the Israeli threat and the agreement with Iran. This is weakening the nuclear race between Pakistan and India. After this legacy of Bush, will Obama continue to deceive the American people as with this weak economy? And if this is the reason, If the United States is responsible to protect the world without an international cooperation?
Yes. Is there a connection between Bush and Nixon in terms of their policies? Getting into wars, of course, Nixon argued that he got us out of the Vietnam War. Actually, what happened is we got out of the Vietnam War because we lost. Mm-hmm. It's quite, you know, that got dressed up as peace with honor. So I don't think there is much connection there, quite frankly. The issue, I was talking with somebody here at the center this afternoon about, you know, what gets handed off mm-hmm. when Obama's out of office to the next president. And there was an interview last month that Charlie Rose, of who's an anchor in American television, did with Vladimir Putin, the Russian leader. And at one point, Charlie Rose said to Putin, said, well, you were in the KGB. You were a lieutenant colonel in the KGB. And there's a saying that once you're in the KGB, you're always a KGB officer. And Putin just kind of sat there and he said, I mean, it's one of the great answers of all time. He said, not a single part of our lives passes that doesn't leave a trace. Very interesting way to say, yes, I'm still a KGB guy, which he is, but it's a brilliant answer because nothing passes in our lives that doesn't leave a trace. And what the business of journalism now, when you have all these people who want to be president, what are the traces of their lives? Where did they get their values? How did they make decisions? Who are they? We've got to dig into that and explain it to people in a very serious and detailed way. And you know, what is going to be handed off is probably a very difficult situation internationally. And I joked with a friend of mine that whoever is elected president of the United States next year, as soon as they're elected and declared the victor, that person should go to commander-in-chief school for about 2 or 3 weeks and learn about the most important part, perhaps, of being president, and that is the military, being in charge of the military. And how are you going to use it? How are you not going to use it? How are you going to, when you have the largest military in the world, you have immense leverage. Doesn't mean you have to use it ever, really. Look at Reagan again. He really never used it in a big way. It was always these small CIA wars almost all of the time. So you need to get a president who can use that leverage and use it wisely. And, you know, there are a lot of candidates out there running for president who you do not necessarily associate the word wise with.
If you may ask you, sir, according to Putin's answer, so I'd like to turn this as a question to you also. So throughout your life, what traces have you actually come across and you never forget?
The traces of my life?
Yeah, as a reporter, not as a husband, okay? Because she's here.
Okay. And this illustrates the point that those traces are important. When I was in high school in the 1950s, I worked as the janitor in my father's law office in a suburb of Chicago. And as a janitor, you go down at night and you clean the offices, and that's when everyone smoked, and you dumped the cigarettes, and you cleaned the washrooms, and so forth. And you do this kind of week after week after month. And I noticed that there were papers on people's desks. And I started reading the papers on the desks. And I discovered that in the attic, they had what they called the disposed files of cases that had ended in my father's law firm, in this town, Wheaton, Illinois, 25 miles west of Chicago. And you would look, and this supposedly was a perfect town where everyone did the right thing, and there were never serious problems. But then you looked in the disposed files, and you discovered that there were ugly divorces, there were tax cases, there were all kinds of scandals that had been covered up that we didn't know about. And so I came away from that experience saying, when my last year in the Navy working in the Pentagon and seeing the reports about the bombing in Vietnam that showed it was a disaster, it was not working. But then Nixon and the defense secretary and the generals and admirals would go out and say, oh, it's great, we're really having a real triumph here with this bombing, and it was a lie. So when you have those two experiences, there's only one thing you can do, and that is become a reporter.
We have time for just one question. Please.
Hi. Yeah, my name is Sam Kuo from Chicago, okay. Currently working here at Abu Dhabi at the new
Emirates Nuclear Energy Corporation. Thank you for this inside story of the Obama making the critical decision on the war in the Middle East. I'm an avid reader and admirer of your investigative journal. I have a few questions about the extent of President Obama's recognition and understanding of the ISIS. I remember he spoke about the ISIS to the New Yorker magazine in January, quote, if a JV team put on Laker team, that doesn't make them Kobe Bryant. In your observation about President Obama inner thinking, do you think that the White House still believe those groups are not particularly sophisticated and that do not pose a significant immediate threat to the U.S. interests or the U.S. homeland? You mentioned in your book that the White House led a secret exercise showing that showing how unprepared the government is if terrorists set up a nuclear bomb in the American city, which President Obama told you at the top of the list of what he worried about all along. My second question is, do you believe that ISIS had the capability and the willing and the ready to strike any major city around the world?
The question,
and the third question
ISIS,
and the last
what?
One, do you think President Obama has come up with a comprehensive strategy that assures Americans that this attack will never have a chance to happen? Thank you.
What's the goal? I'm sorry.
Your question, sir, about this, Obama's strategy towards ISIS, the first one? The first question
one?
Was about Obama's strategy towards ISIS?
Well, the second question is...
The first one.
The first one. Okay.
We'll have only one question. So
the most important question, I just like to know that the terrorist set up a nuclear bomb in an American city. He mentioned that in the report directed to you in your book, you know, and... I just want to know that do you believe ISIS had this capability and the willing to ready and the strike in any major city in the world?
Is the question, is there some terrorist cell in the United States?
Nuclear in your book.
Yeah. When I interviewed President Obama for this book, it was interesting. He said that the game changer for the United States would be if a nuclear weapon went off in an American city. And he said all of a big portion of the intelligence operations were designed to make sure that never happened. And if you're asking, you know, is it working? It's worked so far. But, you know, this is the great problem. This is the terrorist nightmare of you don't know what a handful of people can do. And, you know, last quick point to illustrate this. Take the 9/11 terrorists, 19 hijackers. Mohammed Atta was the lead hijacker. One of the things that never came out in all of the investigations was when Mohammed Atta came to the United States, I think it was 18 months early to train and to recruit the people for this operation, he opened on the internet an account with Barnes & Noble, the booksellers. Mm-hmm. And the first two books he bought, one was about how to lead a group of people. And the second book was a book on the theory of the collision of solids. And somebody said, you know, if we'd known that and thought, you know, why is somebody buying a book about how to lead a group and buying a book about what happens when solids collide, like an airplane into a building, it would have tipped us off mm-hmm. that something was up. but you never can put that together. No one's that smart, and no one has that good intelligence. So we are incredibly vulnerable. The war, I mean, look what happened in Paris. And so it is a time where, you know, put your seatbelts on and keep them on. My final thought.
At the end of this valuable lecture, and on behalf of His Excellency Dr. Jamal Sanad Swedi, Director General of the Emirates Center for Strategic Studies and Research, I'd like to express my sincere thanks and appreciation to Mr. Bob Woodward and to you, all of the attendees. And I'd like also to invite you for a dinner that will be held at the center's restaurants. Thank you again, and I hope to see you again.
Thank you. Okay.